Okay, let's start. Before starting, let me ask you one thing. So before you are extremely tired, do you want to do? So I will be around. Matthias left, so he's about to leave while we are here. So there won't be. He won't be around in the afternoon. I will be around today and the whole next week. Do you want to do the Q&A today or not? And you have other plans, whatever, and we do it next week. It's up to you. Just you can raise your hands. Who wants to do it today? Okay. It's clear. Very good. Okay. Then next week we will maybe share it a bit with Shlomo and we can decide on the way and we will see. Okay, good. So let me just start by summarizing a bit what we did yesterday. So the most important point that is essentially what we are going to do also today, so the way in which we are going to continue, is that we saw that conformal symmetry constrain the space-time dependence of two and three-point function. And in particular, from the two-point function, we can read off the conformal dimension and the spin in general, which can be, I put it here L, but in general it can be any representation of SOD, depending on which kind of operators we are talking about. Let me tell you something that I forgot to say yesterday, that what I showed you yesterday was how conformal symmetry fixes two and three-point function of scalars, but in principle fixes also any operator, any primary operator. It's just a bit more complicated. There is a tensor structure which takes into account the Lorentz indices, but everything is fixed. And then there is the three-point function, which is essentially a set of numbers that yesterday we called F. And what we discussed is that this set of information for primary operators defines what it is called the CFT data, which completely specify the full content of correlators for the conformal field theory. In particular, we saw that this information together with the operator product expansion allows us to reconstruct all endpoint correlation functions. As we said, this is a bit abstract, and in particular, it's hard to make it work because we need to know all of them. So it's a bit complicated to reconstruct, let's say, a 5, 6-point function because we would need to know all the operators that appear in the CFT, which might be a bit too much information to know. But that's what we discussed yesterday. And then the last thing that we discuss is how we can study 4-point correlators. And in particular, we discussed identical operator. So we saw that conformal symmetry fixes this 4-point function to be of this form. And U and V, I will rewrite it here because I'm going to need it soon. And V is 1, 4, 2, 3, and the same denominator. In some references, you might find different conventions, but the only important point is that there are two of them. then how you define is not very important. In this course, I will define them this way. And also notice something else, that when we write this 1, 2, 3, 4 here, also that's a convention. We could have chosen to put out some other points here. So for instance, 1, 3, 2, 4, but we are somehow assuming that while writing that, we are somehow secretly considering the OP of these two guys somehow. I'm going to become a bit more explicit later on, but just remember it on the back of your mind. Then what we discussed yesterday is that we can rewrite this GUV in this form. So we can write it as a sum over the dimension and the spin times the three-point function square, or the three-point function of O and this O delta L, times some special function that I called capital G, which are labeled by delta and L, which is the dimension of the operator which appear inside the OP of them. And this function is completely fixed by conformal symmetry. And we are going to see in a second how to do that. And, okay, what else do I want? Ah, yes, something else that I wanted to say is that in this particular case, I show you how to do this for operators which are identical. Indeed, one can do the same for operators which are not identical. In that case, this function here, so if, say, we have some delta 1, delta 2, delta 3 and delta 4, this object will also depend on delta 1, 2, delta 3, 4, where delta 1, 2 and delta 3, 4 are just delta 1 minus delta 2, and the same for delta 3, 4. So generically, this object will depend on these differences. And indeed, if you have a four-point function of different operator, here you still have the other parts that I showed you yesterday. So that will be still the same, but when we would decompose the G, we would need to put some other structure for the block. Yes? It's only on the difference.
Yeah, but delta 1, 2, delta also delta 1, 3.
No, only on that. Yes. Sure. And the only thing that we depend on the other thing is this prefactor. So you remember yesterday I wrote the prefactor. The prefactor will still be the same, but when you would decompose the GUV, it will depend only on these differences. And we are going to see actually now why that's the case. Okay, question on this part, which is, yes?
It seems, I don't have any intuition for why the conformal blocks can be a function of given B, but still fixed by conformal symmetry. I mean, if it's a function of the cross ratios, then it can't be fixed by conformal symmetry, right?
Structure of the function is fixed by conformal symmetry. It's not that, I mean, indeed, this is a function, so it's not.
I mean, so from the left hand side, we have this little lower AB. Mm-hmm. This is not fixed by conformal symmetry.
Yeah, yeah, okay, let me say this. It's not fixed by conformal symmetry because it's a four-point function. It's fixed by conformal symmetry because we are using the operator product expansion inside it.
Okay.
It's not fixed as being a four-point function. So if it's fixed, so by looking at this relation, conformal symmetry fixes for us only the fact that this is a function of UMV. Now, here we are putting an extra input. We are putting the extra input that we are taking the operator product expansion between these two and these two. And this allows us, since the operator product expansion is fixed by conformal symmetry, then these two information together will tell us that the functional structure of the block is also fixed by conformal symmetry. I will explain in details now, but this is a bit the idea. More questions on that? Okay. So what I'm going to do now is how and how we can essentially, sorry, some, okay. How we are going to fix the function, this function, at least in principle, and we will see some expression of the function itself. Before doing so, let me do something that will become important later. Yes?
We have the dependence of the conformal dimension of delta 1, 2, and delta 3, 4, because we are secretly doing the B for.
Not very secretly. Yes. Yes. Yeah, yeah. Otherwise, it would be the opposite. So, whatever you fuse together, it will come inside. Okay, so there is a pictorial way to show this relation. Please don't confuse it with Feynman diagram. I won't show almost any Feynman diagram on this course. It's just a pictorial way, so it doesn't have anything to do with Feynman diagrams. But the idea is that we can write GUV in this way, like a sum over delta and L. You could say, why then are you drawing that, but. So what you see here, that's clear what we are doing. So we are taking the operator product expansion of these two guys. So when we take the operator product expansion, we are putting them close to each other. So that's the idea here. And the same we do from x3 to x4. And in particular, here you see where the three-point function comes from. So you see here three-point vertices from these two, and those are the three-point function. So this is lambda, opa, O delta L, and the same here, lambda O delta L. So this is just a pictorial way that shows how we can interpret this. Generically, this is called conformal block decomposition. And sometimes these functions written in the way I have written them yesterday, they are called the partial waves. So sometimes also partial waves decomposition. Okay, so the idea again is to show those guys running inside are the operators that appear in the operator product expansion, and the remaining ones are what they are called external operators. So these lines essentially shows the fact that we are taking the OP between these two and the OP between these two, and you see that there is one operator here. In particular, notice that here, since again we have identical operator on both sides, in this channel we only have this operator transferring, because remember yesterday that the two-point function is diagonal, so we will get a delta function. Okay, this is the only new thing that I show you today. Let's try to understand again a bit other properties of these functions, because those are very interesting. I don't remember if yesterday I made it, but let me make one claim about this function. So the conformal blocks are eigenfunctions of the quadratic and quartic Casimir operator of the conformal group. So I will show you one way to compute them without using the operator product expansion, because one way to do them is to do what I showed you yesterday. So if you remember yesterday, I said that in principle you could take the operator product expansion. There is this function that I called the lambda hat yesterday. So you could take the two lambda hats, plug them inside the four-point function, and then you would find a relation for a kind of functional structure of this for this G delta L. This is possible, but this is very cumbersome. One way which has been more efficient in general, actually, the way in which the structure of the conformal block can be found in dimension greater than two, because in two dimension maybe you already have seen them in the 2D course, how to find them. But in dimension greater than two, the way in which they have been found is by using this method. So if you say that the eigenfunction of the quadratic Casimir, it's enough. I mean, it's a bit complicated, but it's enough to build the Casimir and then solve the eigenvalue problem. I will show you a bit how to attack this problem, and then we will see why this is interesting. So just to refrain a bit on the question before, you see also from here that function is fixed by conformal symmetry, because being the eigenfunction of the Casimir, now you can ask why is the eigenfunction. I will show you now. Okay, in order to see why this is an eigenfunction, we can go in radial quantization, and in radial quantization we can study this four-point function in this way. So I will just invert a bit the order, but again we are going to still have in mind the same. Sorry, I wrote x4. So the idea is to take, we are thinking about it in radial quantization. And we are thinking about this operator, which are living on the sphere, separating x1 and x2 from x3 and x4. So we are taking this kind of configuration. And then what we can do, we can insert inside this correlator a projector that will project this correlator into the conformal multiplet of the operator. I'm not tall enough, but if you look up there, we would like to insert a projector inside this four-point correlator that would project into the conformal multiplet of the operator O delta n L. So I will write it in word here. So we would like to insert the projector, which will project into the conformal multiplet of O delta n L. So the way is essentially that we can rewrite this full structure, this full part. So, okay, we know that our four-point correlator is this object here. So we will see that the full correlator can be written as O3 x3 O4. x4, and then here we plug our projector. Because somehow let me try to explain the logic. So if we go here, it is clear that what the conformal block is doing, the conformal block is taking care of a single operator, a single primary operator with all the descendants which appear in the OP of these operators here. So somehow what we need to do, we need to insert our projector that will project the full four-point function into the contribution of that particular operator. So somehow it's like when you do the usual decomposition in quantum field theory that you would like to see how when you do some Fourier transform with respect to some basis, let's say Legendre polynomials or whatever, you would like to understand to which kind of contribution you are looking at. In this particular case, since we would like to understand the contribution of this particular operator inside the conformal block decomposition, we need to project the full correlator inside that. Okay, hopefully it will stay. So we need to project into that operator there. That's why we use this projector. Now, this projector in general is, yes? So here we would like to understand what is G. So it's a single one. So let me say, okay, sorry. So one term, let me call this object here W, which is the partial wave of O. So W is equal to that. Okay, so it's only one of them, it's not all of them. So this is not equal to that. Okay, so now this is a bit cryptic because somehow this projector, I didn't want to write it for you, but can be written as a gram matrix with some coefficients. It's not very illuminating. The way in which instead is a bit more illuminating is to see it in terms of the quadratic Casimir. Okay, let me remove this. So we can write down our quadratic Casimir in this way. C2 is one half, is the usual Casimir. I don't know how you called the generator in the 2D course, but those I's are nothing but the SOD plus 1,1 generators, so the usual. I didn't want to redo everything, but those are just the generator of the conformal algebra, so I'm sure you did it in the 2D case, so those are essentially the same. And now what we are going to do, we are going to insert this operator here inside our expression. Let me do it for you. So we have O3x3, O2x2, then we have P, delta L, C2, O1, yes, x1, O2, x2. So why do we want to do that? We want to do that because when we act on the left with this operator C2, we end up with this eigenvalue equation, P delta L C2 is equal to C delta L, this is a smaller C, this is the eigenvalue, C2, sorry. Yeah, P delta L. So you clearly see that when you act it on the left, you just gain this eigenvalue, and the eigenvalue, let me write it for you. This is delta, delta minus D plus L, L plus D minus 2. So this is the eigenvalue of the quadratic Casimir. And when acting on the right instead, so when we would act on the right, it's possible to find the form by looking at the form or the structure of the generator, and then we can use the commutation relation of the generators. Notice, again, one thing that I said yesterday. So here, here there is a D, D is the dimension of space-time, so remember yesterday I said that the blocks were depending also on the dimension of space-time, this is the way in which the dimension of the space-time enters. So when instead it acts on the right, so when the P acts on C2, we can see how the generators are written, and we can study the commutation relation of it. So for instance, if you remember, we can look to our generator. For instance, P mu is proportional to D mu, and so on and so forth. So we can rewrite them in this way. And then the conformal blocks will just be a solution. Let me write it here. So there will be a solution of a second order differential equation that I will write it for you. So I will write it for operators like that which are different. And let me use this parametrization here. So I will call U, Z, and Z bar. This has been introduced, this variable, by Dolan and Osborne, who first find the structure of the conformal block in even dimension. Okay. So, if you introduce these variables, the eigenvalue problem that you need to solve is this one here. Now I'm introducing these labels because the dimension of the operator is different. And this D has this, this form. So plus 2 D minus 2 Z Z bar over Z minus Z bar 1 minus z dz minus 1 minus z bar dz bar. Now let's see what those curly d are. So this is 2 z square times 1 minus z d square z minus 2 plus d 3 4 minus d 1 2 z square dz plus d1, 2, d3, 4 over 2 times z. And now, one way to find, which again is the most efficient, to find this function is by solving this eigenvalue problem, where this c is exactly that one, and this dz, sorry, in this differential operator is, as you see, is a second order differential operator in both Z and Z bar. Now you see already one simplification. You see the simplification that when D is equal to 2, this differential operator is decoupled, so you have dz plus dz bar, and that's it. Yes? Sorry, I didn't hear.
How do we see that G should be the eigenvalue of D?
C is the eigenvalue of...
Why G is the eigenvector of the D operator?
Okay, so you build the D operator in such a way that this is the case, because essentially you start from here, no? So by looking at that, if you act with P on C, you only end up with CP. So here you have CP. And then essentially by using the commutation relations of both the projectors and the full structure of C, you end up with that differential operator. So one way essentially is you take this, You take all the generators, you write them in a differential form, then you start using the commutation relations, and then you end up with this relation here. So it's like you write down your full Casimir, the same way you would write a Casimir, and then by writing the Casimir and using the fact that when you act with P, you gain a C delta L, you can write the relation up there. So is your confusion coming because you don't see how G enters into this relation here? Okay. This is equal. Unfortunately, no, it's here. This is equal to this W. W. So being equal to W, you see that this is equal to G delta and L. Okay, so because when we insert this P delta L, we are projecting into one element of that sum there. And then we are using the fact that C2 is the Casimir in order to write the structure for G. Okay? Is it clearer now? More questions on that? Yes?
You have to repeat the same thing, but how is this P defined?
So the P is it's a bit complicated to write it down because it's like the Gramm you need to use the Gramm matrices in order to write that P. So what it does, it's a projection of the full correlator into the conformal multiplet of the intermediate operator that you exchange in the OP. So what it does is looking, so you have that GUV can be written over all the possible operators that appears inside the OP of the two operators that you are considering. Now, this P, what it does, it focuses to the contribution of a single operator inside this sum. So you want to just probe the contribution of a particular conformal multiplet. Because a conformal multiplet essentially is given by the primary plus all the descendants related to the primary. So what this projector does, it projects you in the full four-point correlator into that specific representation. So essentially, you focus, instead of looking at the full sum, you focus only on one element of that sum. And this is what it's a regular projector, so it's just a cat-bra operator with some coefficient in front. More questions on that? Okay, so as I said, in two dimensions, solving this relation is a bit simpler. And you see that again, sorry, this is a bit weird, but it's the same D upstairs. So you see that the equation factorizes. And let me write for you the structure of the block. So this G delta L, delta 1, 2, delta 3, 4 of ZZ bar is written in this way. 1 over minus 2 to the L, 1 plus delta L 0, this is just a Kronecker delta, K of delta plus L Z, K of delta minus L Z bar, plus the Z interchanged with Z bar. So what are these K? Okay, I will write the K here. K of beta X is X beta over 2 and the hypergeometric function beta minus delta 1, 2 over 2 beta plus delta 3, 4 over 2 beta X. So this is the regular hypergeometric function to F1. Sorry, regular, maybe the regular is another one. This is the regular, I mean the generic, F2-1 with this structure. So you see that the conformal block in two dimensions takes this form. So it's essentially a combination of hypergeometric functions. Now, one can also find the conformal block in a similar form in four dimensions. They have been found in this paper here, both of them. I didn't give you the paper. I can give it to you on Monday if you're interested. And there you can also see exactly how they did the full procedure. So in D equal to 4, the solution is this. No, no, this is only D equal to 2. This result is true in any number of dimension. This is only D equal to 2. Now I will write the D equal to 4, and then we discuss it a bit. It's pretty similar, so minus 2 to the L, Z, Z bar, Z minus Z bar, K delta plus L, Z, K delta minus L minus 2, Z bar, minus Z going into Z bar. Where I write Z going into Z bar, it means that you will have K delta plus L Z bar, K delta minus L minus 2 Z. This is what I mean. Now you see two things. You see, first of all, that indeed, due to the fact that now this piece will contribute, because delta minus 2 is not 0, is something, you have a piece which mixes the two parts, which is this part here. So you have z, z bar over z minus z bar, which was absent before due to the fact that there was this disentangling of the two equations. And instead, for any other different than two number of dimensions, you have that this bit contributes and this piece is always there, so you see it here, and then you have something similar happening. Now, I would like to make you another point that is a bit harder to see from this equation here, and is that if d is equal to 6, one can also write a similar relation to that, which is, again, found by these people in the paper, but so far we don't have any structure, any closed form expression for conformal blocks for odd D. So, in the case in which, for instance, the number of dimension is 3, there is no way in which people manage to solve this eigenvalue equation there. And my take on this problem is the fact that somehow, in the case in which the number of dimension is even, that kind of differential equation is essentially almost, so in the two-dimensional case, is exactly two copies of the generating function of the hypergeometric function. So you take hypergeometric function, if you go to Wolfram Alpha in the Google, which is what everybody do right now. Before, when I was a student, there was the Gradstein. Now you open Google, it's much simpler. And you see there that hypergeometric function, they satisfy a lot of differential equation, and one of them is the one that is the generating function. And it happens that the hypergeometric function R, essentially, they have as generating function two copies of this differential equation up there, and that's why it gets, in the two-dimensional case, it gets this very nice form. So actually, the hardest bit in this paper has been to find the proper parametrization. So doing this parametrization here, which now we find it very useful, and it's something that we don't even think about, has been essential, crucial, in order to solve for this differential equation here. So the hardest bit was to write it in the proper coordinates, and this is what these people did. And in two dimension, you get exactly this nice form. In four dimension, you find something slightly more complicated because there is this extra term. But if you try to do in three dimensions, you see that your equation is not the generating function of hypergeometric functions, so you don't know what to do. And maybe something that one One way out could be in the future to have that mathematician will work out another set of functions that they will be called whatever. And then when you know the structure of those functions, you might be able to find blocks maybe for all space-time dimension, and then those ones will be just some reduction of this equation. But so far we don't have that. Okay, so yeah, said that, it's not that we don't know anything about blocks for all dimensions. We will see at the end of today's lecture, I think, that there are ways, there are some specific limits of Z and Z bar that will give an approximation also in all dimensions, so people know it in some way, but they are not known in a full closed form. And we will see why having it in a closed form is interesting. Okay, question on this part. We are going to move it a bit gears now. If you have questions before I erase, otherwise it might be a bit complicated. Okay, I will start erasing. So now that we know how to compute the blocks, we know how we can use the OP inside the four-point correlator to reduce it in this very nice form. We will try to do another almost innocuous manipulation. We'll erase everything and then... And we will see what happens. Sure? Yes, you can. The problem is let me say, we will discuss that at length, but the quick answer is that if the series expression is around Z and Z bar going to zero, what happens is that sometimes, if you have infinitely many operators, the sum that I showed you before develops some singularities. Singularities like 1 over 1 minus Z, 1 minus Z bar to some power. Those are not captured by finitely many terms inside this expansion. So that's one of the drawbacks. So now it's a bit more clear how to find this kind of divergence is also without knowing the full expansion, but having the full expansion would be helpful for this for these cases. Sure?
Is it okay to say that the conformal blocks are in somewhere, a representation of the conformal group is the same as the representation in this
group? Can you say the second part? I understand if it is a bit louder, that I'm a bit deaf.
Is it in some representation of conformal group which is the same as the representation in which O data transforms? Because it seems like it's also identical.
Indeed. Yes. Yes. So the conformal block are related to the characteristic of the conformal group in that particular representation. So essentially, you focus on a particular representation of the conformal group, the way in and you decide to project on that particular representation, and then the conformal blocks are fixed in that specific representation.
So there should be a one-to-one correspondence between states in some particular representation and the conformal blocks, right?
Yeah, yeah. So this is what you do in general in the operator state correspondence. In CFTs, that's the way in which it is transformed. So a state corresponds to one operator in the CFT, and that's what is behind this mechanism. And also, sorry, I will finish answering, then you can ask. Another thing is that you can ask another question, like how abstractly you want to construct the conformal partial wave of the conformal blocks when you change representation. So let's think about changing representation, and then you would like to find the relation between the two partial waves. And this is something that is a sensible question to ask, and people have tried to give an answer to that using group theory and representation theory. Yeah, go ahead. You had. Okay, more questions on that before I start this new block? I have to erase another board, so you have a bit of time to think about it. Okay, so what we are going to do now is to take, again, the four-point function of identical operators. So we go back to the beginning of today's class. But instead of taking, so we saw that one can take this OP here, and if we take this OP, we end up with this object. Now, the operator product expansion is associative, so we can also take another OP. For instance, we could take this OP, and the result should be unchanged, meaning that the four-point function is the same. We can decide to pick another OP, and indeed, picking the two OPs should be exactly identical. So if in order to go from the white OP to the reddish OP, the only thing that we are doing, we are essentially, since we will be taking an OP between x4 and x1, before it was between x3 and x4, we need just to exchange x1 with x3 and x2 with x4 in the relation that we had above. What that means, let me rewrite for you a bit u. Sorry, I just erased it, but and v, sorry, 3, 2, 3, 1, 3, 2, 4. Now you see that if you, let's do it. So if you take a u prime in this new exchange, so this will be x 2, 3 square, x 1, 4 square over. This will be its invariant under this transformation here. And let's look at the v prime. V prime is x14, so it will be x2, 3. And no, sorry. This will be x1, 2. X 3, 4 square over x square 1, 3, x 2, 4 square. So I just swapped 2 with 4 and 3 with 2. So you see that u prime is exactly equal to v, and v prime is exactly equal to u. So by changing, by instead of considering the white OP, you consider the red OP, you have this exchange. So this means that this is a G of VU instead of UV. And now, again, this part here is swapped into this one. So it will be 2, 3 to the 2 delta, x, 1, 4 to the 2 delta. And now we can equate. We said that since, let me write it for you, so since the OP is associative, then these two relations, so relation 1 and 2, needs to be equal. No, because now you are taking the OP between 1 and 4.
We are doing the change with 1, 3, and 2, 4 only in G.
Oh, also here, no? I mean, you take 1 and then 2 becomes 4.
1 should become 3.
I mean, the way why we write this is because we are taking the OP between 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. So here we are taking the 1 between 1 and 4 and 2 and 3. Okay? So that's why you get this. Okay, let's now write it close to each other. So we will have that G UV over X12 to the 2 delta O, X34 to the 2 delta O is equal to G VU over X23 to the 2 delta O, X14 to the 2 delta O. Now we can bring this on the other side, so G UV is equal to X12 to the 2 delta O, X34 to the 2 delta O, over X23 to the 2 delta O, X14 to the 2 delta O, times GVU. Now, if you look more carefully to this, this is nothing that U over V to the delta O, GVU. So GUV is equal to that. And essentially, we derived this relation only by assuming that our OP is associative. Okay, so we didn't do anything else than that. So somehow, this is telling us that if I give you a function, in general, a function that you would like to test if this is, can be really be a four-point function or not, you can just try and see if there are some chances that this function can come from a four-point function or not. For instance, if you take a function and this function doesn't satisfy this relation, you know that this can never be a four-point function. Indeed, it doesn't ensure you that it is a four-point function, but there are chances that it is. Now, what, okay, this I said. So this is called crossing relation. Because this symmetry above sometimes is called crossing symmetry. Now, let me write it, that relation. There we can also use it with the expansion that we saw in conformal block. This means essentially that we can expand the white OP there in conformal block and also the red OP in conformal block. What that means, first of all, let me do another thing. So, before we said that one parametrization that was nice was this one here. So, when we swap U with V, we have to swap Z. So, when we take U to V and V to U, essentially we are sending Z to 1 minus E, and z bar to 1 minus z bar. Also the opposite, it's okay, this is just a convention. You could also send z to 1 minus z bar and the opposite, we still do the job, but let's use this convention here. Okay, now I will write GUV in terms, so let's expand it in conformal blocks. Okay, so GUV, we can expand it as a sum over delta NL of the F1, 2. Okay, now since 1 and 2 are the same, I will just say that this F square is a function of delta NL. G delta L of Z and Z bar, again remember that we are in the, this sometimes is called the left hand side, is called the direct channel. This is equal to ZZ bar, which is U, over V, which is 1 minus Z, 1 minus C bar, to the delta O, which is the dimension of the external operator, times sum over delta, now let's put a prime because we don't know if the operators are the same, F square of delta prime L prime G delta prime L prime 1 minus C 1 minus Z bar. Because this means that we are swapping U to V and V to U. Okay? I didn't do anything fancy. Okay, now this is again called crossing relation, whatever. The same, you can use the same words or bootstrap equation sometimes. Now you see something very interesting. First of all, the first thing that I wanted to tell is that this relation is not satisfied term by term. Let me say what I mean. What I'm saying is that if we take a block on the left hand side, this doesn't have this symmetry. Okay, so term by term, you cannot fulfill this relation, otherwise it would have been trivial. Because if we could have said that one single term on the left hand side can be mapped into the term on the right hand side, maybe I wouldn't have presented it today. But then the second thing which is interesting is that, again, if you provide me with a set of three-point functions squared and a set of dimension and spin, so a set of conformal field theory data, I can plug, let's say we are in two dimensions, or four dimensions, in any way where we have the form of the block, you handle me a box with all the numbers like this game that we play in Italy for Christmas, so that you take the bingo game, and I take all the balls, I put it inside, I take my computer, we make this sum on the left-hand side with the delta L, we sum everything, and then we can, if our function has this property here, we can say, okay, the box with the numbers that you gave to me are the OP data of a CFT, that might be the OP data of a CFT, or not. So if I put all of them inside my relation, and it turns out that it doesn't have this nice structure, there is no way in which the box that you gave to me is numbers that OP data that comes from a CFT. The other way around is not true. So if you give me a box and this box satisfies this relation, it might be that it comes from a CFT, but it is not sure that it comes from a CFT. Okay? So it's a necessary but not sufficient. It's not sufficient, so we don't. Okay, this is very hard to do because in general you never have the box with all the numbers. So that's why we are saying that we don't know, because in principle this is in general you can come up with functions which have this property, but not all the functions that have this property. It's like decomposing a function into a basis, because the blocks form also a basis. So if you decompose a function into a basis, it doesn't mean that it's a four-point function. So this is a bit the idea. It's not clear. So for instance, I think in two dimensions people came up with counterexample, because in two dimensions you can take minimal models, for instance. The minimal models are known, you plug all the dimensions for minimal models and you solve it. I said something which might be a bit scary for those of you who work in related topics, because in general performing these sums is extremely complicated. Why performing these sums is extremely complicated? Let me, first of all, this equation looks very simple, but that's not quite the case. So let me say why. So the first thing is that this sum, which are here, they are sums are infinite in the sense that the range is infinite of both of them. And in particular, the sum over delta runs over real numbers. So in general, it's a sum which is very complicated to be performed. So this equation, in general, again, is very, very hard to be solved. Now I would like to say two things about it, and then we move slightly on. And a way to depict this equation, so remember that we depicted before the GUV. The GUV is sum over delta NL of OX1, OX2, OX3, OX4. And again, when we were doing that before, I was saying that this is the OP that we are thinking about it because we take the OP of these two guys. Now we are saying that if we take this OP, it's the same as taking this OP here. And here we have O delta prime L prime. Okay? So somehow this is the pictorial way of thinking about that thing there. So this would be what before I drew in red. But this is again just a way to think about it. There is nothing profound here. Then one constraint that you can see, sorry, this I forgot, let me go back. One constraint that you have, for instance, for unitary theories, you can have two constraints on this. The first constraint is that the F squares are non-negative, because remember we said that the three-point function coefficient are real numbers, so their square is generically non-negative for unitary theories, and also that this delta doesn't run from 0 to infinity, it has some lower bound, which is whatever lower bound depending on the spin you have. So now, again, trying to solve this equation analytically is extremely complicated because one needs to know these Fs and you need to know all of them, so it becomes extremely hard to solve them. And only if you, for two-dimensional cases, one can try to solve them. It has been, as I said, those has been used in the minimal model case. But then people started thinking for a lot of time on how to get some information about the conformal field theory by looking at this relation. And one way which works extremely well is use this equation numerically. So the way in which one can do is essentially use a linear functional that approximate these two sums. So because now one thing that you could say, okay, let's try to truncate this sum. If I truncate the sum to some value here, can I still solve this relation? This we are going to answer to this question maybe next time if I don't manage today to reach that. It depends. So if you cut this sum on both sides just randomly, that's not true. So it's not true that if you put a cutoff on the left-hand side and a cutoff on the right-hand side, you end up with something sensible. That's not the case. But you can take a Taylor expansion on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side around a specific point, and this is a nice truncation that you can do. So you can Taylor expand the left-hand side, so with like what it is called, these linear functionals that you act on the left and act on the right, and then expand around a point. So, for instance, what could be a point which is symmetric on both of them? Symmetric means that if you send z to 1 minus z and z bar to 1 minus z bar stays the same. What? One half. So if you expand around the z equal to 1/2 and z bar equal to 1/2, which means u to 1/4 and v to 1/4, expanding around this point, you see that the two objects are both symmetric, and by doing that, one can, I'm not going to be very precise because I will do the opposite in this course, so try to find analytic solutions to this equation, but I want to mention this method because it's extremely powerful. And so what you end up, if you study numerically that equation, you end up with plots like that. So here you will have the dimension, let me be, yes. So the dimension of the external operator, delta O, and here you will have the dimension of the first. So let's say that O, the OP, contains. So the OP of two identical operators always contains the unit identity inside, plus the lightest operator. So if we order the operators are ordered in here by dimension, which means that the operator, this operator here is the one that has the smallest possible dimension, plus dot dot dot. So this is the delta min and L min, let's say. Okay? And this delta is the delta min. So you can have some exclusion plots, which tells us that I will come in a second to what that means. So it means that if we take that the dimension of the first operator appearing in those sums up there is bounded to be in this region. In particular, that if it would have those values here with respect to the dimension of the external operator, it cannot come from a CFT. So now you reduce the original problem that we said quite a lot. Because before we were saying, okay, you need to hand me the full box with all the operator and with all the three-point functions. Now we reduce a lot the problem. You say that if you give me the dimension of the lightest operator, I can already play the game. Okay? Is it clear why? Okay, can you say a bit louder? So you take this equation, you act on both sides with a linear functional, and then you use the fact that your theory is unitary, so you use the fact that f square is greater or equal than zero, then when you act with this linear functional, like you use a Taylor expansion, you cut, you truncate the sum, and then you use the positivity of the three-point functions to create this kind of plots. So you use an optimization procedure. You say that the linear functional acting on that particular point has to be greater or equal than zero because, and then you keep acting on those possible values and you end up with that. So in particular, what you do, you move. So, okay, let me be a bit more specific. I will do it here. So, the way in which you do, let's say you run delta from some, for scalars is L plus 2 to some delta max, let's say. And then you have your F squares, and then you have your block. Now, what you do, you start, you take, I don't know, L plus 2, then you take L plus 2 plus a tiny bit, L plus 2 plus another tiny bit, and so on. So you create a spectrum which is fictitious, so you put in a fictitious spectrum inside here. You act with a linear functional of this fictitious spectrum. You know that you expand around this crossing symmetric point, so the blocks have some nice positivity around those functions, and you see, at some point, you will see that that crossing relation is not fulfilled any longer. So you do this. You start, you say delta is this. Let's say this is L plus 2. So let's assume that this is a scalar. This delta is 2. So you start from 2. Then you take 2.001. You plug it in there, and you say, OK, yes, this equation is fulfilled. Fulfilled, 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 fulfilled. Non fulfilled any longer. And then you put this thing here. Then you move a bit delta O, and you redo exactly the same. And you keep going and going, and then you end up with this plot. The thing is that this procedure works best for unit. Can you hear me? Okay. This method works best for unitary theories because of this positivity of the OPE, but there are also some methods to do that also for non-unitary theories, but that's not that method upstairs. So again, we have a machinery which it's called numerical bootstrap. Now there are much more complicated stuff. Actually, let me mention another thing that for doing this procedure, just a sec, for doing this procedure, you don't need to know the form of the block. It's enough that you know their expansion around that crossing symmetric point, and this is known for very good accuracy. And this has been done for several cases, and essentially gives us a machinery that if you input CFT data, putative CFT data, is able to exclude if they come from a CFT, or they might come from a CFT. But it is used in a negative way, so it's used to exclude theories, not to prove that they exist, okay? Because you are not sure if it exists or not, yes? Okay, so that's a very good question. The answer is that it's not clear. So, in principle, what should happen is that if we would know that this would be a necessary and sufficient condition, those would be the zeros of this procedure, which would correspond exactly with the spectrum. So this would be the line of where the spectrum sits. But actually, since that's not the case, we don't know what it is. Now, I can tell you that for the case of the three-dimensional Ising model, this procedure has been done. And since we know with other techniques where the first dimension of the epsilon operator sits, one could see that actually that value sits on that particular region. But there is not really, so there are some theories in which one can assume or conjecture that a specific theory sits on that boundary, but it's very complicated to prove it. And in general, there is no way to see it. Yes? Yeah, it's you and then him. Indeed. So there is some error. What I'm saying is that within the error, the dimension is there. So exactly, I mean that it's not here. It's within the error bars, let's say. And the error bars can be pushed. So one way to make this procedure much more efficient is to study more correlator together. So here we are studying one correlator of identical scalars, but let's assume that we want to study a specific CFT, I don't know, in two dimensions. We can also start taking four-point function where the external operator is this guy here, for instance. And then we study the compatibility of crossing with where the external operator is this guy here. And if we do that, for the instance, in the case of the Ising model, this shrunk those region a lot. And actually what one can see is that instead of having an excluded region like that, you have that the allowed region is only an island. And that it becomes much more efficient because you reduce the full space to a small region. But in order to do that, you need to have several four-point functions, and then you need to take a lot of different OPs and so on. We can discuss that more maybe in one of the question session, and I can show you how you can take different OPs to see that you can get. I won't be able to show that the region shrinks, but just to see that the relation that you get are more constraining. You had another question? It's the same? Okay. And yeah, again, the numerical procedure has some error, as any numerical procedures, and in general, the error can be made extremely small. For instance, for the case of the 3D Ising, which is the best studied example so far, the error is smaller than, for instance, the Monte Carlo simulation that one can make, so you can make the error pretty accurate, and the error sits in several procedures. The first way in which the error comes in is because you are essentially expanding this relation. So the more you expand, the less the error is, because the OP converges exponentially. So there are some theories that shows that in that limit there, the OP converges exponentially. This means that if you add a few operators, the other ones are exponentially suppressed. Otherwise, this wouldn't be a procedure that would have worked. And the second thing, the second place where the error comes, so now there are people overcome to this problem in a different way, but it's by essentially truncating the sum on the spin to some value. But now people can also take into account that. So this problem is a bit solved. But okay, that was the idea that I wanted to give this flavor to this story. That's not really what we are going to use, but keep in mind that there are methods in which you can see if your putative CFT data can be excluded or they might come from a CFT. That's the whole reasoning of this full machinery. But there is no way in which we can focus on a specific theory unless we know that the theory sits already there by other, for instance, you do some Feynman diagram computation, if the three-level result sits here, we know that if, let's say that you compute some Feynman diagram computation and you find that the dimension is here, we know that this is a CFT because you know from another method. Okay? The problem is that it cannot be here. We are 100% sure that it cannot be here. If you do something and it's here, most likely you have done a mistake, or the people producing the plots. Okay, so here hence this part of the discussion on how to use this conformal bootstrap technique. What we are going to do now, from now to the all the other remaining five classes, we are going to take that relation upstairs and try to solve it analytically. The point is that, indeed, solving it analytically is, first of all, indeed, is complicated, but the second thing is that it cannot, here I forgot to say that we are not making any assumption in the sense we don't say which CFTs we are going to consider, because this works for any CFT. We are only specifying the dimension of the space-time and the fact that it's unitary, but we don't make any extra assumption on the CFT itself. We are saying that we have an operator product expansion, and this we are thinking about the first operator which appear inside this operator product expansion. But we are not talking about about the specific CFT, about the perturbation theory, about any expansion. We don't do anything in this machinery here. Instead, to find an analytic solution, we need to do some perturbation theory. So we need to find some parameter that we can perturb on. Yes?
So here we're taking identical
operators. Yes. Okay, yes. So if you don't take identical operator, what you see upstairs is not an F square, it would be the product of two Fs. And one can do exactly the same story, but then there you don't have a that kind of relation. You don't know if it's greater or equal than zero, but you know that is positive definite, the full matrix, because let me... So if you do when all the four operators are different, it's a bit complicated, but for instance, you can do two operators which are different within each other. I will do it very quickly, just to let you understand a bit. This is the next to simplest case. So you have one, or two, where one and two, they have different dimension, let's say. So if you take the first OPE, you end up with something which is extremely similar to that, because you would have, so you would have lambda 1, 1 delta L times lambda 2, 2 delta L, and then the block. But then when you take the other OPE, you take this one here, so you would get lambda 1, 2 delta L, and then you have lambda 1, 2 delta L, so here you have a lambda square, and then you have G delta L V U. Now, the way to avoid, so now you see that there is one way in which you can find those objects. And where can you find those objects? By looking at the four-point function of 1, 1, 1, 1, and O2, 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 O2. So if you study the system of these three correlators, then you have relation, you have three sets of equations which will put relations on all these objects. The only one that you cannot find in the they are called the single correlator, is this object here. This is a novelty that you get when you study this one here. So you see that this is what I was mentioning before, to get from the full to the small island, because essentially now, in addition of lambda 1, 1, lambda 2, 2, satisfying their own relation for two different four-point functions, they also need to satisfy this one here, because now this is positive, because it's the square of something, and those, they come from those two, but they cannot be whatever. They need to be in such a way that this object gives to something with square, positive square. Is it a bit clear the logic? So you add extra, this is indeed this more complicated because you have several relations which are also, and you have more unknowns because now this OP is different from the one you would have, but it's more constraining in general. But it requires, generically, the error bars are a bit bigger in this procedure here because the kind of procedure that you need to take is more involved. More questions on this part? Okay, so what I was saying before, this is that what we are going to do now. We are going to study, the first part we are going to study a bit abstractly, how we can study this equation. We will see that actually the way to study this equation by using perturbation theory around some places by going from this fully Euclidean picture that we have, we need to go into Lorentzian. And so we need to study the same story, but in a Lorentzian signature. And we need also to understand a bit better how the blocks behave. So I would like, how much? Okay, 15 minutes. So let me start a bit a discussion on how we can treat this equation in a Lorentzian form. And then we will continue on Monday. And this is essentially the idea. So the idea is to come up with a machinery that will allow us to perturbatively find the solution to that equation there, and then we will put that in connection with amplitudes on using the DSCFT correspondence or using any holographic correspondence. Okay, so in particular, we can think about, so we would like to understand the difference between Euclidean and Lorentzian. So any configuration of point in a four-point function, what I mentioned before, is conformally equivalent to the one where the four operators insertion are on a plane. And in particular, we can decide to parameterize the operators in this way. So we can restrict to space like separated operator. And we can take a plane which is defined by a time-like coordinate and a space-like direction. So this will be a plane x0, x1. And then we can think about, so our points will sit on x1, x2, x3, and x4. And now we can fix x1 to be at the origin. Then we can say that x2 sits at x20, x21, and then 0, 0. Then x3 is 0, 1, 0, dot, 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 and then x4 will send it to infinity. This is like just a configuration. Now we can build our cross ratios out of these points here. And we will see that z, so z and z bar are the usual, u is z, z bar, and v is 1 minus z, 1 minus z bar. So we see that z is x21 minus x20, and z bar is x21 plus x20. And the space-like separation, what I mentioned before, tells us that z and z bar needs to correspond, needs to belong to 0 and 1. And in these configurations, the conformal blocks are real valued functions of Z and Z bar. And the Lorentzian configuration can be reached by a weak rotation from Euclidean from the Euclidean, yes, signature, where Z and Z bar are complex conjugate of each other. So somehow what happens when we go to Lorentzian is that our coordinates now become independent. So Z and Z bar are not any longer complex conjugate of each other, but they are independent of each other. And now we can take, if we are in the Lorentzian signature, we can take several limits. Let me just show for you one limit for today and then we will end. We will do the other limits tomorrow. The first limit is the simplest one. So, since we can treat Z and Z bar now independently, there are many more limits that we can use. So, let's take the first one. Let's take Z much smaller than Z bar, that is much smaller than 1, which would say that U goes to 0 and V goes to 1. And in this particular limit, the blocks behave in this way. So G delta L of U and V can be written. This is general, this is an equality. We are not inside the limit. Now we take this specific limit. And this will be U, I will introduce in a second what tau is, tau is delta minus L. So, what do we see from this? This is completely independent of the number of space-time dimensions. So you can take the limit in which Z and Z bar are both very small, and in this particular limit you see that, first of all, it makes sense to classify operators using what it is called twist, so this tau is called twist, or conformal twist is the same, and then you see that in this expansion, when you do the leading order, will essentially project you on the operator which has the smallest possible twist. We will see on Monday what that means, but this is the first order when we take this kind of limit. This is called the OPE limit. We will understand a bit later why it is called the OPE limit. And the one in which instead of Z you get 1 minus E and 1 minus E bar is called the crossed OPE limit because it's the one that you would get on the other channel. Let me end today's class just by a quick summary of what we did, and we are going to discuss that part and glory details next time. So this is just an appetizer of what we are going to do. But today we have seen that when we use the fact that tower OP is associative, we end up with a condition which is necessary but not sufficient in such a way for our dimension and OP coefficient of a conformal field theory. And we saw that actually this is very simple to derive. We could derive it on the board without many problems, but it's a very constraining equation. In particular, we saw just in a sketchy way how to compute bounds, numerical bounds on the dimension of the lightest operator. And we started now instead turning a bit the gear in order to study, to find solutions, analytic solution of those equations there. So next time what we are going to do, we are going to study even more limits of this relation, and then what we are going to do, we are going to take a conformal field theory which has some gauge symmetry, SUN for instance, and we will take n as a perturbative parameter, so we will take a large n expansion of our equation, we will try to set up a perturbation theory around the large n. And hopefully by the end of the lecture, we will understand how to do it systematically. And if you have some questions now, you can ask, or otherwise, Monday, we have plenty of time before the lecture to discuss it. Okay? I will be around in the afternoon, so if any of you have some questions, I'm... Guarda cosa dovremmo